began with an invocation by Virginia Division Chaplain Ron Graves. Chaplain Graves?
Before I start, I'd like to read one of my favorite quotes. It's from Robert Louis Dabney, Chief of Staff, Stonewall Jackson. Sirs, you have no reason to be ashamed of your Confederate ancestors. Make sure they have no reason to be ashamed of you. Bow our head, please. Today we remember Dr. Weaver, whose efforts over 3 years would result in the reinterment of over 3,300 Confederate soldiers, 2,900 plus are buried here in Hollywood. We give you thanks for his brave and honorable command. We give the Lord thanks for Dr. Weaver. We give you thanks for the person who supervised this effort. The greatest care was taken. We give you thanks for all those who have joined in a sacrifice for peace and justice. And we'll give thanks for the bravery of the men and women who took care in honoring and preserving the memory of our ancestors, wherever they may rest in peace. In a world that is still torn and broken, we declare that Jesus is Lord, that hope overcomes despair, that joy overcomes sorrow, peace overcomes hostility, that love overcomes hate. Lord, we lift our heart to you. Continue to remember, to love you. This and all things we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Our executive, excuse me, our executive director of Sons of Confederate Veterans, Colonel Michael Landry, will now lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance and the salute to the Confederate flag.
Shoulder arms. Present arms.
Ladies and gentlemen, I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The Confederate flag, I salute
the Confederate flag with affection, reverence, and undying devotion
to the cause
for which it stands.
Amen.
I'll now call on the second lieutenant commander of the Virginia Division Sons of Confederate Veterans, the Patriot Everett Ellis, to bring greetings and recognition of our guests. And that's probably going to be one of the toughest jobs out here because there's always a chance I'm missing somebody. So make sure you get everybody over.
All right. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
On behalf of our division commander, Tracy Clary, and the 2,800 compatriots of the Virginia Division, Sons of Confederate Veterans, I bring you greetings and a warm welcome to one of the prettiest cemeteries in the whole dominion. I'd like to recognize a few of our dignitaries. Our commander in chief, Mr. Kelly Barrow. The treasurer for the 10th Division, Mr. Bill Grant. Our 2nd Brigade commander, Les Updike. Is there anyone that would like to be recognized? Our executive director has already spoken about recognizing him again, Michael Landry. And welcome to our ranks. Thank you to the ladies of the UDC and also the Order of Confederate Rose. I want to give a special thanks to the staff at Hollywood Cemetery. General Manager David Gilliam was instrumental in helping us plan this dedication, and grounds foreman Kenny Gentry was instrumental in helping us with the installation of this marker. So we hope that your visit to the Old Dominion, the capital of the Confederacy, is a very pleasant experience for you. Thank you very much for your attendance today.
Now, if you don't already know, you're going to find out when we unveil the marshal. And everybody's going to, we're always going to have a little overlap of the speak, and that happens. One person says one thing, one says another. And when you're talking about the same subject, it's hard not to overlap a little bit. You are standing on what's known as Gettysburg Hill. We all know Gettysburg. We know how many died at Gettysburg. Over that direction, you'll see a monument that says the probable last resting place of General Richard Brooke Garnett. He's the one that had to ride the horse. Could have been excused because his leg was injured. But no, he rode the horse. And they told him, you know, you'll be sure you'll be a target. But he led his men. And we believe he rests here. Almost 3,000 dead from Gettysburg. Well, why don't we just lay it down, Daryl, this way. We'll lay it flat, too. Now maybe we know why Hollywood wanted to put the marker flat. The marker you see on this is not this marker. It's the marker in Gettysburg. And I'm going to talk a little bit more later about that. But what we're doing here is we're honoring the men that made that charge. And they were from so many different states, not just Virginia. The Virginia flag you see here, the Virginia flag you'll see at the convention, only mean welcome to Virginia. Does not mean this is a Virginia thing. And there were so many others besides Virginians that went into that charge. But it's most famously known as Pickett's Charge. General George Pickett leading the Virginians across that field in Gettysburg. We have some speakers today, starting with the great-great-grand-nephew, because he is the great-great-grandson of General Pickett's younger brother and aide, Major Charles Pickett. So I'm going to call forward Henry Clay Pickett, descendant of General George Pickett.
Hi, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here today honoring Dr. Weaver and his extraordinary deeds and efforts that he took upon himself. I'm very proud of my Confederate ancestors, as I am of all of our Confederate ancestors. We need to remember them, we need to stand strong for them, especially today in this time of all this political turmoil and this hatred against our heritage. So I'd like to say thank you. God bless you all, and God bless Dixie. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
I'm now going to call Colonel Michael Landry, our Executive Director of the Southern Confederate Veterans, Colonel, if you will.
It's been a beautiful day. I think God is smiling down on us and thanking us and saying, what a great, you're sending his blessings to this ceremony. We have a beautiful weather. It's in July. I can't believe it. You know, as a young boy, I would visit Gettysburg, and I'd say, after a while, I said, where's the Confederate dead? And, you know, where's the Confederate cemetery? I had no idea. I kept asking, where's the Confederate dead? I don't know. And it was only later that I found out that they weren't here. And rightfully so. You know, they didn't belong there. They belong right here. In other places in the South, Charleston and Savannah. Richmond. You know, after the war, our ancestors had nothing. Nothing. 150 years ago, our ancestors were beginning Reconstruction. They called it Reconstruction, but we know that it was deconstruction. It was the enslavement of the South. It was the destruction of our Southland. And wherever they hadn't destroyed already, they were destroying starting in 1865. If you ever wanted to know what our ancestors experienced 150 years ago, well, now you do, because that's what's happening today. But you know what? Our ancestors, the daughters and sons of these brave men, you know, they collected money. And it wasn't very much money, because they had nothing. They had nothing. And they put together these monuments, these memorials, and all these glorious, glorious monuments. They're not as good as the northern memorials. They're not nearly as good, as beautiful or as grand or majestic in stature. But you know what? We paid more with what we had than what they did, and it wasn't out of lack of love, it was out of lack of funds. But they put these things together, and they donated them, and they dedicated them, and they gave them to the institutions and governments to take care of. These monuments were made out of stone and metal. They were not made out of paper mache. They were not made out of cloth. They were intended to be always perpetual. And it's the role of our governments and these institutions who took them and embraced them. It is their duty and honor and responsibility to ensure that these monuments are taken care of. Today, I don't think that that's happening, and it's a great threat to our people. What is the difference between this and what ISIS is doing in Afghanistan, in Iraq? There's nothing. There is nothing. After the war, Dr. Weaver, his father, was asked to exhume the Confederate dead and ship them south. And he started it, but he didn't finish it. Dr. Rufus Weaver, his son, actually took that on. He was in Northern. He was told he would be paid. I forget how much money it was per body. $3.75 a body. And he exhumed them. And he transported them south. He never got paid all that he was supposed to. He probably got paid about half. And yet, even though the money stopped trickling in, he still exhumed these bodies and sent them south. We owe him a great debt of honor to him. We've already paid it once in Gettysburg. This is a picture of the marker that's in Unity Park. And we were there just 10 days ago in Unity Park to dedicate that park. But this monument is right there. This marker is right there in Unity Park. Unity Park. Isn't that exactly what we're expecting? Isn't this what our ancestors did 150 years ago? They put down their rifles, some of them grabbed their horses if they had them, and they left everything, everything that they fought against, and everything that they fought for, and they walked home, and they became good citizens. Good citizens, and they became the ambassadors. They became ambassadors, they became generals. Two Confederate generals served in the United States Army as general officers during the Spanish-American War. Joe Wheeler and Fitzhugh Lee. These men went back, and as General Forrest and as General Lee asked these men to do, they went back and became good citizens. There was an era of reconciliation. 102 years ago at Gettysburg, when they had the 50th reunion of Gettysburg, these men who had fought themselves against each other 50 years earlier reached across the stone wall and they shook each other's hands in friendship and love. And yet, 100 years later, we're still at each other's throats. And I don't think we're the ones. They're at our people's throats. We just want to be left alone. We just want to honor our ancestors. We want to honor our heritage, the heritage of freedom that our ancestors provided for us, first in 1775 and later in 1860. These are the same principles. Our ancestors, our Confederate ancestors said, we are fighting the second revolution, the second American Revolution. And they really, truly believed this. They were fighting for the very principles of self-government, of states' rights. And that's what we honor here. Who is not here is Dan Schmiedelkoffer of Camp 1939. This is his and Riley Gunner's brainchild. When Danny, whose ancestor fought and fell at Gettysburg, found out about his ancestor, he was in an Alabama regiment. And he found out about Dr. Weaver. He said, "Whoa, we have an opportunity here. We have a man who sacrificed himself for other men. Wasn't he on the same side? He was from Pennsylvania. And he dug these men up and gingerly sent them home. General Pickett, who led the charge there on the third day, he met every train that came in. He met every train of these soldiers and met them at the station and brought them here and watched them be buried. This is love, gentlemen and ladies. This is love for our ancestors. This is a debt that we owe them. We have a responsibility. I'm sorry that Danny can't be here, and I'm sorry that Roddy can't be here, but they asked me to speak on their behalf. And this is my camp in Tennessee, that helped us. And of course, the Virginia Division. And every camp, and every division needs to provide money for this, because it's still not paid. We still owe a little bit of money on it, okay? But these are our boys. These are our boys that were brought home here. And we owe a debt to Mr. Weaver, to Dr. Weaver. And I think we have another debt we need to pay to him in Charleston. I think we have one in Savannah. We have one in Savannah. So we have other locations that we need to in Atlanta. I think it's the other one, right?
I think Charleston. Oakwood, North Carolina has already placed a monument before the project started for Dr. Weaver.
Thank you for that. So we owe Dr. Weaver. We not only owe him a monument, a marker, but we owe him the love that we have for his love of us. Thank you.
Most of y'all know me and know I've held several positions in the Sons of Confederate Veterans. And the higher you get, what that means is the more places you have to be at one time. Won't see him listed in the program because we knew he had to be a lot of places at one time. We weren't sure he'd be here. But our Commander-in-Chief, Commander Kelly Barrow, is here. Commander-in-Chief, sir, would you like to make any remarks?
Appreciate everybody being here. Thank you for honoring Dr. Weaver. Let's remember what he did. It's always just a cause here in our heart. We'll never forget these great men for the cause they drew his life. So thank you.
I deliberately put myself last as a speaker in the program. I'm Frank Ernest, proud to have been the commander of the Army of Northern Virginia, proud to have been the commander of the Virginia Division of Sons of Confederate Veterans. Our executive director, Colonel Landry, put myself last to kind of clean up anything that might not have been said, but Colonel Landry pretty well covered it all. Like you said, Samuel Weaver did so much move the northern graves. That's why the ladies got a hold of him, and he was killed in a train accident. His son really didn't want to take over the project. I don't think he had anything against our Confederate dead. He just had other things in life. You know, it was when somebody comes to you and says, hey, can you head up this committee or do this project? But he agreed to do it. And he received little enough pay, and as the colonel said, the money ran out, but he kept sending. There's just a couple of things I want to point out to you. One, Dan Spittelkopper has been mentioned. Many of us are older, we have health issues, he wasn't able to be here. He's been here before. Last year we marked the grave of his ancestor, an Alabamian over here on Gettysburg Hill, Bobby Crawford. Dan contacted me 2-3 years ago now. I'm not gonna say too much about this stupidness, this silliness that's going on, this prejudice and bigotry that's going on towards us. We didn't just rush out here and put this stone to upset somebody. It's been years in the making. Any of you who've done this know it takes a lot, contacting everybody and getting the stone and getting it on. We were in Gettysburg last year, Dan, my wife and I, others, gentlemen here. And we dedicated the one in Pennsylvania, and then we did the one here. We want to continue on. And I don't usually like to do a commercial during a ceremony, but I'm glad Colonel Landry brought it up. The little basket was intended for that. This needs to be finished up, being paid for, and we want to continue the project into Charleston and Savannah. So anything you want to put in that little basket, either here or up at the hotel, would be greatly appreciated. Dr. Weaver was a great man. Dan Schmittelkopper, the man who started this, was a great man. He called me up never been to Gettysburg. He was going to run up there one day, find a place to put that mark, and come back. I said, Dan, it doesn't work like that. I said, when you get to Virginia in Williamsburg, about 60 miles from where I live, I said, I will come pick you up. We will spend the night in Gettysburg. We'll get with Jim Balmazano, with commander of the Pennsylvania Division, who lives in Gettysburg. And we'll find a place for that mark. And we did. And then we did everything else to get it made. And then we continued on, working to get this marker here in Hollywood. I mentioned it before, and the thing I want to mention to you, this is a problem that President Davis had, it's a problem we still have. We're all fighting for states' rights. This is Hollywood Cemetery. These gentlemen, most of them, we got some Virginians, but most of them are Marylanders. They'll be real happy to know that our ancestors said the Pennsylvanians were plowing through our ancestors' bones in their fields when they plowed their crops. They took bones, some of them jawbones with gold teeth. Dr. Weaver had to pay farmers to get remains back. Moving graves around. Kind of reminds you today, doesn't it? Something's going on. They didn't want that story told. They loved it in Gettysburg that this sign would go up modern one of theirs, Dr. Weaver. But they told Dan, we're not saying anything about anybody taking bones and gold teeth in them. They still have descendants living here. Well, we're proud of what our ancestors did, and they need to stand up for what their ancestors did. It was said, that's what I'm saying about the Marylanders. They said, we're not worried about those Southerners in Maryland soil. That's Southern soil. That's friendly. They'll be well taken care of. But they said, we want the ones brought back from Gettysburg. And over 3,000 were brought back, almost 3,000 here, a few more to Oakwood Cemetery in Raleigh, Cemetery in Charleston and Savannah. We want to keep this up until it's done. If you get a chance, if you want to know more, Hollywood Cemetery, The History of a Southern Shrine by Mary H. Mitchell. There are other writings, but this definitely goes into some of the things that were happening there and how all this came about. We really owe a debt of honor then to Dr. Weaver, and now to men like Dan Schmittelkopper, and also to General Pickett, who every time these remains came back, met them and walked with them to this cemetery. And it also says in this book, I don't want to go on forever, about the other crowds and the Virginia militia and the police and everyone. And it says when this man was buried, General Pickett, half the city of Richmond turned out. They didn't do that for any other reason than to honor their war dead. If anybody asks you what we're all about, tell them that. Honoring our war dead. Honoring those who died defending our various states. That's all there is to it. It's that simple. All that other stuff is something they're putting into it. Honoring our war dead. The last word in our name, Sons of Confederate Veterans, is veteran. That's what it's all about. All right, at this time, this marker is going to serve a dual purpose, because not only will it honor Dr. Weaver, but it will explain all those who may not know exactly what Gettysburg Hill is about. And you're about to see exactly that when it's unveiled. I'd like to call my wife, Billy Ernest, historian of the Suffolk chapter of the United Daughters of the Confederacy, and Ian Pierce from the Reverend Beverly Tucker Lacey Camp, Sons of Confederate Veterans, come forward and help with the unveiling of the marker. Ian was in the neighborhood, he was only 3,000 miles away, so we said, come on over and help you there. We have the Virginia flag, welcome to Virginia. We have the Third National. You know, they've been talking about the First National, but they probably wouldn't like this one. It's got a battle flag on it, too. But it is our true national flag, Third National. And this flag flew, when you see on the pole, it flew up until now. When yesterday, and it will be presented to Dan Schmittelkopper. Third layer of bunting covering the monument was the bunting we used in Gettysburg for the monument there. So even the covering has significance. If they only knew. But you know what? They don't want to know. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you our newest monument to Dr. Rufus Benjamin Weaver. May it be there 500 years from now.
Amen.
We'll now have the rifle and cannon salute.
He's got a place to live.
Alright, we're about to bring the ceremony to a close. One thing I didn't include, but I will, past commander of the Maryland Division, Clarence Wood, would like to place a wreath. I don't see any other wreaths that wouldn't include in the ceremony, but I certainly appreciate the honor. The Maryland Division. I know we're about to wrap up. Hold on. I can't thank everybody. Everett Ellis does such a great job, Commander Ellis, on our President Davis Committee and taking care of the gravesite on the other end of the cemetery. I highly recommend you get up there and take a look at our President's grave. Couldn't have done this without Everett. It's been Dan Schmidl-Garber's project, but he kind of turned it over to me here in Virginia. Men like Lee Hart, Philip Wood, Robert Shirley, Ian Pierce, the Stellar Guard, the rifle squad, the cannons. I hope I'm not leaving anybody out. It takes a lot of people to go into this, and to you to be here to dedicate this. Like I say, pray God that 500 years and beyond, it and all our other monuments are all here. With that, I'll go. I think I'm going to reverse this. I know the last thing is supposed to be the benediction, but I'm going to call for Chaplain Ron Graves to come give us a benediction.
Here we close our hour, our heads, please. Father, at the close of this special dedication, we came together today to honor Dr. Weaver for all he did for the brave Confederate soldiers that gave their lives at Gettysburg. Difficulties, as strong in mind and spirit as Dr. Weaver was in 1871. Help us follow the example of this godly man. It is with joy and thanksgiving that we've had this time, this dedication, knowing that the true history of the Confederacy will live through us, and it is our duty to keep it alive for future generations. You bless all who took time to gather, especially the ones who made the plans for this event and worked so hard to make it happen. We ask for your hand of protection on all the, as we continue our journey, some to the SCB reunion, others to their home. Keep our actions, our words, and our decisions always acceptable to you and for your glory, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Maryland, Ask Maryland Commander J. Berger, close us out.